We continue to follow our breaking news, the mass shooting at the VTA rail yard in San Jose.
There have been several mass shootings, as we know, in this country so far this year, more than 200, as a matter of fact. And joining us to discuss this trend of gun violence is San Jose State Professor Greg Woods. He teaches in the Justice Studies Department. Good morning. Thank you for joining us, Professor Woods.
Well, it's good to be with you this morning, unfortunately, under these circumstances.
Yeah, and you know, you ask anybody on the street and they'll tell you, boy, it just seems like this is happening more and more often. You're a good person to ask. You have a historical perspective on the trends nationally. Are we seeing this more often?
Well, we certainly are. For all measurements, we certainly are. Statistically, it seems infrequent, yet these are very high profile, high kill numbers. Unfortunately, people are dropping at just record numbers. This is something that we began to pay attention to in the 1980s. You may recall Going Postal, workplace violence. And now as we repopulate and emerge from isolation, we're seeing the same kinds of trends that we were exposed to for the past few decades, now increasing.
You know, it's interesting you bring up the pandemic because it does seem like maybe nerves are frayed a little more, patience is tested a little more as people come out. Do you think that is playing a part in all of this, or is it the proliferation of guns? There's so many variables to try and, you know, find answers in.
It's a perfect storm of horrible behavior. We're looking at ultimately desperate people behaving desperately. If we are considering the workplace act that we are analyzing from yesterday or any of these other mass shootings, we are exposed to the fact that these individuals have engaged in a profound amount of planning, accumulating the firepower, figuring out how it is that they will premeditatedly eliminate those people. And from what we're hearing yesterday, on that list, those list of individuals who were obstructions to his control, his personal control, which ultimately leads us to power and control being exerted over those people to whom you might very well feel powerless. And this is something that we are seeing. We can profile it. The question is whether or not we can prevent and adequately respond to it.
Yeah, the response, that's the question, especially from politicians and lawmakers. We always see in the wake of actions like this a call for gun control, a call for legislation, for something legal to be done. And yet it seems like it's moving at a snail's pace, at least on that front. What's been suggested to you in the data that you look at?
Well, we can look at gun crime and any number of instances of gun crime. We might consider those crimes being accomplished with the use of a firearm that has been stolen or accumulated in an illegal way under the table. Therefore, these kinds of legislative maneuvers will not impact the criminally minded individual. Further, we have to remind ourselves that most of these mass shootings have been perpetrated with guns that have been purchased legally. Therefore, we must be able to look to a number of factors that indicate whether or not the individual who is in possession of the firearm is intended to use it in, the worst way possible.
What do you think it's going to take to stop this trajectory that we're seeing, right? With this rise in mass shootings, what do you think it's going to take?
We can look to other industrialized nations around the world, and we can conclude that this might very well be uniquely an American experience. And therefore, it is something that is indicative of the American culture, perhaps no more profoundly expressed than it is now. So we must change the culture. The question is, how do we go about changing the culture? How do we reverse the clock when we glorify hyper-violent entertainment, video game, other kinds of sources of revenue, which might very well be accumulated illegally or through the use of a firearm? And then we look to the power and control measures that an individual who feels desperate due to a totality of circumstances, not the least of which might very well be the isolation And if we consider suicide, and perhaps this is just a grandiose way of taking one's final bow. I mean, after all, this can only conclude in one of three ways. Either they will be placed into custody, as has happened, or law enforcement officers might take out the shooter, as has happened, or they might take out themselves, as so frequently happens, as it did yesterday.
When it comes to assault weaponry, and we don't know specifically the weapons that were used in this, we know that he had a couple semi-automatic handguns, other weapons found at his home. There are calls, as we know, moving through houses of politics and legally as well to try and ban assault weapons once again. They were banned before. Were crimes like this, mass shootings, down? Does the data show they were down when these types of weapons were banned versus now? Where does that argument stand?
Well, what we need to understand is that we have regularly set sales records on the purchase of firearms. And after every high-profile incident like this, it is an invitation to set yet another record. So, at last count, there have been more firearms in the population than there have been people. What do we do with so many firearms that might very well scatter to the winds after a person either abandons that firearm or perhaps relinquishes its title? What happens to these firearms? Do they cease to be? And the answer is no. So what we have to do is change the culture. We must incentivize people who are either willing to return these killing machines, or we should hold the manufacturers accountable. One of the ways that people are being held accountable is through sentence enhancements, the ghost gun initiatives. However, with 3D printing and other kind of criminally minded individuals who might very well receive their arms mm-hmm. through trafficking measures that are outside of the bounds of the law, no amount of legislation will counter this trend. It must be something that we all collectively decide to move toward. This is a collective gut check where we must work together to identify those individuals, those factors, those sources from which.
Oh, and I think we may have just lost the professor's signal there, but he was making the point that maybe it's not legal, but more societal and cultural changes that we need to look to. To try and change his,
yeah, he brought us
and he said
good
the
points.
Trajectory of where we're going.
Where we're going, right.
We'll take a break. We'll be right back.